Okay.
You're risen, will you join us in singing our opening song, In the Sanctuary?
We will praise you for the rest.
this time, O God, we ask that you would draw us close to you. Give us listening ears. God, give us open hearts. Take from us every distraction that we might have, that we might truly praise you and give you our lives completely and wholly. In the holy name of your Son, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. Hi, I'm Dr. Dean Coffey, and I'm the vice moderator of the board of directors. And I'm happy to welcome you to Founders Metropolitan Community Church. And I'm wondering, do we have any visitors here for the first time? If you would you just raise your hand? We'd like to give you a little flower, a little love. Yes, we're always happy to have newcomers. And we also welcome our online community. We feel like you are a part of us, that you are an important part of the ministry of Founders here. And of course, we welcome all of our regular attenders. It's good to see many familiar and loving faces here in the house of God. This morning, we have a very special privilege to have Reverend Barbara Haynes, who's going to be speaking. Yes. I knew I was going to introduce her, so I Googled your name, Reverend Barbara. That means that I looked for you on the internet. And I found out that you are a YouTube sensation. I don't know if you knew that, but... Reverend Barbara is a wonderful woman with a beautiful voice, and she has a powerful message for us today. It's not only her voice that's anointed, but God's put a wonderful message on her heart to share with us. I'm going to ask you now to take a few moments and greet your neighbor, share the peace of Christ one with another.
Reading is from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29, verse 11, from the New International Version. It's also my favorite verse. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Please rise as you are able.
I'm going to teach you something. It goes like this. For I know the plans I have for you, and I know just what you're going through. So when you can't see what tomorrow holds and yesterday is through, remember I know the plans I have for you. Come on and sing that with me.
today. It's the reading of the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 8, verses 31 through 38 from the Message Bible. Jesus warned them to keep it quiet, not to breathe a word of it to anyone. He then began explaining to them, "It is necessary that the Promised One proceed to an ordeal of suffering, be tried and found guilty by the elders, high priests, and religious scholars, be killed, and after 3 days rise up alive." He said this simply and clearly so they wouldn't miss it. But Peter grabbed him in protest. Turning and seeing his disciples wavering, wondering what to believe, Jesus confronted Peter. "Peter, get out of my way. Satan, get lost. You have no idea how God works." Calling the crowd to join his disciples, he said, "Anyone who intends to come with me has to let me lead. You're not in the driver's seat. I am. Don't run from suffering. Embrace it. Follow me, and I will show you how. Self-help is no help at all. Self-sacrifice is the way, my way, to saving yourself, your true self. What good would it do to get everything you want and lose you, the real you? What could you ever trade your soul for? If any of you are embarrassed over me and the way I'm leading you, when you get around your fickle and unfocused friends, know that you'll be an even greater embarrassment for me to the Promised One when he arrives in all the splendor of God, his Abba, with an army of holy angels." Hear what the Spirit says today. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen. Let's sing. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, Jehovah Nissi, Lord, you reign in victory, Jehovah Shalom, my source of peace, and I worship you because of who you are.
To speak to my own family one more time. Would you please pray with me? Creator and maker of us all, bless the words of my lips and the meditation of my heart. Grow in us. Show us your way. Inspire us to live to your level of truth. what the difference is between involvement and commitment? If you've been to Denny's or any of the restaurants and you had yourself a plate of ham and eggs, I would say the chickens were involved, but the pig was committed. So this morning, I would like to preach a message that calls us, hallelujah, put on some glasses here, to be committed and not simply involved. It seems that there was a barber in a small local town who had been the only barber in town for years. The only one there. How many years? 48 now we have. We used to be the only church in Los Angeles for gays and community. Everyone went to this barber to get their hair cut. Then one day, a big salon franchise came to town and opened up shop. They advertised all haircuts for $3. Slowly, the barber's business began to dwindle. He just couldn't compete. In a last-ditch effort to save his business, he hired a business consultant. The consultant spent a day poring over the barber's books, asking him many questions. And at the end of the day, the barber asked the consultant, "What do you think? What do you think? Should I close up shop?" The consultant said, "Not yet. I'll be back tomorrow." The next day, the consultant showed up with a huge banner that he hung in front of the barber shop that said, "We fix $3 haircuts." Some Christians have looked for an easier and a cheaper way to the favor of God. There isn't one. So allow me to share with you how God can fix the $3 haircut in your life and take you to the next level. As you can see by my illustrations, there are no shortcuts. Only God takes you to the next level, not Marvis Staples. She can't take you there. Now, let's listen to our text one more time, at least these verses, 32, 33, where Jesus predicts his death for the first time. He talked about it, quite frankly, with the people that were there, and Peter took him aside and rebuked him. He said, "You shouldn't say that, Jesus. You shouldn't say things like that. You've healed the sick. You've raised the dead. You made the blind to see. You made the lame to walk. You walked on water yourself. You fed 5,000 people with 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. This cannot happen to you. You're the power here. We won't allow it." Jesus turning and seeing his disciples wavering and wondering what to believe, he turned to Peter very sternly, and he said, "Satan, get behind me. You are looking at this from a human level and not from God's level." Then he looked back at Peter, and he said, "Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to have you, to sift you like wheat. But I have pleaded in my prayers for you that your faith should not completely fail. So when you have repented and returned to me again, your strength will help you to build up the faith of your sisters and your brothers. As followers of Christ, Jesus is telling us, he was telling them, to go to the next level. We must stay on our toes. Stay on your toes. The enemy will use the people in our lives, in our history, in our experiences, in our thoughts, in our emotions, to discourage us from going to the next level, from reaching and receiving our wholeness, accepting our invitation when Jesus included you and me on that cross in his resurrection in 3 days. God is calling founders to our next level. This church is a building. You are the church. You're the people. This church building can stay here, I don't know for how long. But God is calling founders, you and me, to the next level of wholeness. We have people who have come to our building for years, and they've never been committed. They're involved. They're involved. God is calling us to a level of wholeness. And we can't go there. It's a power that we get through a growth process. It's a power we get through the relationship process. And the lessons we learn while we're on the process provides us with the wisdom we need to grow to our spiritual maturity. If we don't get it, we ain't moving. We will only be going to make the same mistakes over and over and over again. Some things God has to lead us to. You say, just as I get everything all figured out, got ourselves a good leader, everything is working for us, growing, programmed, working like we like. Jesus comes in and says, you've got to move. Just as my boss, Jesus' boss, his father, had future plans for him. He told him, he says, I have future plans for you. The invitation comes through Jesus Christ. It's a tough invitation. He says, follow me. That is the key to wholeness. There are places we can't go until we accept that invitation and allow God to take us to our next level.
All right.
When your faith and determination is fixed on going to your next level of wholeness in this church, somebody's angry. God is glorified. Your testimony is magnified. And the enemy, old Satan, the devil, he's horrified. When you make a commitment for next level growth, next level promises, next level faith, next level living, you are declaring war against the forces that challenge you mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Isaiah 54:17 says, it lets us know God has our back. We don't have to be afraid. We can open that door. God knows the plans that God has for us here at Founders. In that coming day, Isaiah says, 54:17, in that coming day, no weapon turned against you shall succeed. And you will have justice against every courtroom lie. Hallelujah. As soon as you commit yourself to accept the invitation of holiness, as soon as you commit to go through the process to get to the next level, remember, no shortcuts. You are taking a position that says, God created me to be a factor, to be a force, to be an expression of power and dominion and authority in my life and in the lives of people around me. The Bible teaches three powerful wisdom principles for growing to our call to holiness. And each principle will have a different application in your life. But the key is you must have a next level state of mind. You got to be that ham. You cannot be the egg. You must be the ham. You make a commitment. You're going to stay. Somebody hurt your feelings? Somebody called your name. Somebody ignored you. Somebody didn't give you the respect or regards that you thought you should have had. Hallelujah. Get your mind set to next level movement because you know who is going to be right there saying, oh, no, you don't. But you can say, get thee behind me, Satan. Because God says, I'm going to do it. You know, I was talking to some of our members outside the door after church, the 9 o'clock service. And for us who know we older. We sit at that television and we say, what's wrong with these kids? Why are they doing this? Where is their minds? Have we ever told them about Satan? Have we ever told them about the evil spirit that is out there that is against what we say? Have we? It's our duties. God is calling you, Founders, to wholeness. To wholeness. He wants you to get that message out. That invitation comes through Jesus Christ. There's no other way. No other way. You've got to have a next level state of mind. One that biblically connects us to our spiritual self and the plans that God has for our life. Principle number one. We don't go to our next level. We grow. G-R-O-W. To our next level. Just like we had to grow from childbirth to adults, our spiritual walk is the same way. The children of Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 years before they walked into the promised land. David was a sheep herder for years before he became the king. Sarah was barren for 90 years before she became the mother of the nations. The woman with the issue of blood searched for 12 years before being helped. Each of us is anointed to go to our next level of wholeness. that we serve a sovereign God. Amen. What does that mean, Barbara? We ain't in charge. We're not in charge. That's what it means. The God who gives us an anointed time and an appointed time. Like I said, there are no shortcuts. You can't move before God moves you.
Amen.
Job said, all of my appointed time, all of it, I'm going to wait till my change comes. His wife told him to curse God. His friends told him, Job, you're all sick and hurt and everything. This God you got, he don't care for you anymore. Job said, that's all right. I'm going to wait till my change comes. Hallelujah. Yes. Your anointed time is a time for growth and preparation for the invitation to receive Jesus, his invitation of wholeness, hallelujah. You are always where God intended you to be. You don't have to try to move ahead. If I had been here, or if I had not been there, or maybe if I had moved to this town, or maybe if I'd quit this job and taken that, I need another church over there. This choir don't do like I like. God support me. To learn what God intended you to learn in order to grow, you already have it for your next level. Your next level of healing, your next level of appointment, the next level of vision. It's in you. It's right there. You are anointed for greatness. Your next appointment is not the result of time. It's the result of last level lessons learned. I don't care if I was here when these doors open. And you just walked in yesterday. Doesn't make any difference. I'm here that long and you just coming in because I didn't learn nothing. I have to stay until I've learned what God wants me to learn to move to the next level. That's it. We must ask ourselves, what's challenging? What is our challenge today? What has been a consistent pull on our greatness, our distraction to your learning? What's stopping you? Is something or someone causing you to wander in the wilderness of your history? In your emotions? Feelings and your thoughts or your beliefs. Principle number two, your highest and best self is connected to the worst feelings, emotions, to fear and oppressive thought that you carry. Listen, we are not who we think we are. What we carry, it doesn't matter what level we are on in life, the seed that we plant and carry in our souls determines the harvest produced in our mind. What we attach our thoughts to will determine how we look at life. How we look at opportunities, people, and challenges, and our power in Christ. Whatever oppresses your thoughts or the truth will depress your potential. Overcoming, growing, transitioning, prospering is not because of faith alone. but because of the condition of the faith. Faith is what we believe. Amen?
Amen.
Faithfulness is what we do about what we believe. Someone might say, you have faith. I have deeds. And I'll say, show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds. By my deeds. Growing to our next level of wholeness requires our committed participation in the actions that nourish and support our connection to our highest and our best self. The Holy Bible tells us what to do and how powerful our minds are. Be made new in the attitude of your mind, and to put on the new self, created to be like God. Ephesians 4, 22, 24. True righteousness, true holiness. Sometimes our divine and anointed self requires that we do the work. Don't just sit there with faith. I got faith. God's going to give me some water in a minute. God's going to give me the money for my rent or my lights or maybe my new car. Self requires that we do the work through faith. Just to disconnect from thoughts, emotions, and habits, and even some people that prevent us from stepping up to the next level of wholeness. If there be a thought, emotion, or habit that you need to stop carrying in order to grow to your next level, take a leap of faith to become disconnected. Take a stern look at whatever is blocking you from your growth, just like Jesus did. No matter, we know Jesus loved Peter. We know Jesus loved the people. Because he told them he was going to die for them, but he's going to get up in 3 days. But he looked at them sternly, and that's what we have to do when they're trying to block you. Get thee behind me, Satan. And don't be afraid. Do it sternly. Look them in the eye. Satan is so happy when we are afraid to use his name in our midst. Because he know he's free. He can ramp up and down like he wants to. Because nobody is going to identify him as a friend to your weakness is an enemy to your wholeness. Our power, our potential, our hope, and our promises are based on the wisdom that we use in life. The Holy Bible tells us the beginning of wisdom is this. Get wisdom, though it costs all you have. Get understanding. Proverbs 4, 7. Growing to or moving towards our potential task, growing in wisdom and understanding. Every level in life. Every level. Preparation for your next level. Remember that. You're going through something right now? God is preparing you for something better. Always take it and look at it from that point of, where do you want me to go? Talk to your daddy. Where do you want me to go? What do you want me to do? Dad, what do you want me to do? Next level wisdom comes from the last lessons learned. To unbreak our hearts, to move beyond our hurts, to overcome to challenge life's difficulties on our own peace, accept our losses, walk in authority, and to mature our faith and our wisdom has to align with our faith. We must always believe, James 1:6-8, we must always believe without a doubt that Jesus Christ is the way. When we pray, pray with confidence, believing that you've already received. You need wisdom. Ask our daddy. Growing to the next level of wholeness is not a destination. It's a process. The Life Application Bible tells us that our lives are transformed by the renewing of the mind. Renewing is a process that we go through daily. Renewing our mind is the conscious act of the Holy Spirit, repairing, replacing, rethinking thoughts and beliefs that restrict us from gaining or growing and using wisdom. 2 Corinthians 13:5. Anything, the devil is included, that keeps our mind, our heart, our emotions from gaining or using wisdom is an enemy to our wholeness. Don't treat it like a friend. It's an enemy. Expose it. I know you love me. I know you mean no harm. But that's not the words of the Lord. That's not the words that's in the scripture and the promises that we have. So rebuke it. Put it behind you. Any thought that threatens to cancel our next level, our self-esteem, our appointment, our potential, our wholeness, our greatness, our living, our best life is a friend to our weakness. Give yourself to Jesus and humble yourself unto the Lord. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Going to our next level of wholeness is appointed to our anointed mind. Going into our next level in wholeness is a process that takes faith and work. Powerful next level living is a result of what we do, about what we believe. Jesus is calling you, founders, to your level of wholeness. It's an invitation. You owe it to yourselves to accept this invitation. An invitation to the next level of wholeness. As I said before, it's not a destination. Our invitation to wholeness is a state of mind. It's a process that takes us from one level in Christ unto another. We face some disappointments here. We've had some ministers. We've had them trying. But that was not God's election. That was ours. God is calling us to our next level in life, in love, in worship, in relationship, and the lessons we learn in life on each level provides us with the wisdom we need to grow to the next level. If we don't learn it, we're going to repeat it. We have an invitation. It's from Jesus Christ. He invites us to wholeness, to let go of anything that stops us from growing, from reaching where God wants us to be. Is our faith in line with our beliefs? Or are our beliefs contradictory to our faith, to our power, our potential, our promises? Are you feeding your mind with truth and wisdom? You get that from reading your Bible. Are you taking the steps to address mental and emotional issues that are either a friend to your weaknesses or an enemy to your commitments to wholeness? I would like for you to know that there are battles that we cannot win until God takes us to that next level. We're going to have to be prepared. We're going to have to be committed. We can't go there without God allowing us to go there. We have to say yes in our minds that we are ready. Use me, Lord. I'm ready to go to that next level. Maybe God has spoken to you about going to that level, giving your life to Jesus Christ. Amen. Ephesians 2:8 says, "For by grace are you saved, through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God." Amen. Maybe your next level, if you're visiting here this morning, is becoming a member of this church. Amen. Commit it. If you're a member, you become committed. If you're a friend to the church, you become involved. You become involved. Surrendering your life to Christian service. Say yes, God. If I offend you, if you're a Jewish here, and I know how you feel about pork, but for just this one time, be the ham. Be the ham. God bless you.
Special treat. Kim Donesh's niece, Marlena Prater, is here to sing for us. Will you welcome her as she comes to sing?
Thank you.
We just had a moment. You know that scripture, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope, is followed by another verse that says, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. And that's what I believe God is inviting us to do with all of our hearts. Beautiful. Thank you, Marlena. You have a ministry. God bless you. You may have noticed the flowers here in the sanctuary from the celebration of life service that we had yesterday for Dr. Carol Scherfenberg. Her homegoing, there were about 300 people in this place. It was packed. The balcony was full too. And I think it's a message to all of us of what's possible and what is yet to come that God has for us. Wow, if you open your bulletins, notice with me a few announcements. Things are moving forward in the property committee as well. God blesses that ministry. We have a plan for landscaping the front of the building that the board has approved. And immediately following the service, we will have representatives out in front of the church to share with you what the plan is. We are planning a work day for next Saturday at 10 o'clock. You are welcome to come and bring your shovels, not just to be involved, but to be committed. We're going to take out those ugly mounds of grass and replace them with some beautiful plant material. So we invite you to give to that as God leads you. Our roof repair is going to also start a week from Monday. And we're just so happy in the blessing of the Lord, what God is doing in our midst. At the same time, another sister in Christ, Jewel Jr., made her transition to be with the Lord, and her service is also going to be on next Saturday at noon, which will be followed by a reception. And so we want to invite you to come and to participate in that. As the ushers come, I want to remind you that this is the fourth Sunday, and on the fourth Sunday we receive a second special offering for the benevolence ministries of the church. And so as God leads you, feel free to come and to give your offerings. There's many many more announcements here, and I'm going to just leave them to you to read, and God bless you as you give.
Blessings, the material blessings in our lives. We thank you for the opportunity to give back to your ministry, to your work, to your heavenly purpose. God, we ask that you would just use these gifts that we have offered to your glory and to your benefit. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
You know, Troy Perry used to say, when you come to FCC, we're going to teach you in so many different ways, you're bound to like some of them. One way we haven't used on you in a little while is an altar call.
All right.
Now that means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. Certainly God is right there, wherever you are, can touch you wherever you are. But this is a special spot. This is a special spot because for these thousands of years, as this ritual has been practiced here, our rituals are very important. They carry with them the faith of our ancestors passed down to us. All those people who have lived and tried to walk in this way, the way, capital T, capital W. So when we ask you to come to this place, to the altar, you can think of it like a gateway to the universe. Jesus is the door. But you got to go through the door to something. What you see on the other side of that door might be different from what I see or Barbara sees or anybody else sees on the other side of that door. But the important thing is to walk through it, to take your next step, to move to your next level, to have that catharsis that you've been looking for. Catharsis, you know, we can talk about that in psychological terms and it seems okay, but when we start talking about charismatic and spiritual kind of ways, gets a little intimidating. I don't want you to feel intimidated. I don't want that. God doesn't want that. But I want you to give yourself the opportunity to come to this spot and feel this energy before we use this altar to consecrate communion. Come forward and have yourself consecrated. Come forward and pray with your brothers and sisters, just right here. Come on, don't be shy. If you've got something going on in your life, I know my voice will probably shake a few times because I'm still feeling tearful about losing my friend Carol. You might have some illness, some injury. You might have something going on that may be blocking your profession, blocking your work, some injury that's bothering you and standing in your way, or some injury in your mind or in your heart because somebody's hurt you that's blocking your way. Walk through this door. Would you pray with me, everybody? God, we just come to you humbly. But we come to you purposely and purposefully. God, we ask a blessing. We expect a blessing. We know you are here to bless. And we are here to just turn it over to you. Just this one time, just this one moment, to be open to this encounter. God, so many of us, so many people we see every day, you just feel that they're hungering to encounter you. And it seems like that's so hard to do, and yet it is so easy. Which is what Jesus was trying to tell us all along, is that God is right here saying, I love you. There's no barrier. There's no break. The veil and the curtain in the temple has been rent open. And you can walk right through. It doesn't matter what you think, what you believe, what you've been told. God, we give all of that stuff up. We give up all the religion that we have learned. And just release ourselves to the faith that you have given us. The faith that will grow in us from this time forward. The faith that will get us over this next hurdle, whatever it is in our lives. Whether it be a challenge in our life, in our relationships, challenges with our church, the challenges that our world faces, God, we know you are calling us to all of those purposes. To be a testimony for you if we would just get out of the way. So God, at this time we're proving to you, God, our faithfulness by walking forward and standing here and saying yes. We need to prove it to ourselves. Send us from here, God, knowing that we really did believe. That in this one moment we said yes. So that for every moment following this, every moment is another yes on our way to bigger and bigger and higher levels, deeper and deeper levels. Yes, God, we surrender all. All to you. Our blessed Savior, whatever that word Savior might mean to you, I don't care. the important thing is that you know that you care and that God cares and that you stand together here with God right now. God, thank you for your presence. Thank you for your blessing. Thank you for empowering each and every one of us to be the person that you would have us be. Thank you for Jesus Christ as our example, because we actually do have somebody to imitate. God, send us forward from this place, strengthened in a whole new way, enlivened in a whole new way, enriched in a whole new way, committed in a whole new way. In the name of the one who made all of it possible, Jesus, Messiah Christ.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Computer members were able to prepare their table of communion. Blood and that one is power. To the sea.
Unitarian churches and all MCCs, we practice and celebrate an open communion.
Amen.
This table is open.
Hallelujah.
Yes, God.
That means no matter what you've been told anywhere else, you can come to this table and receive what God has to offer you. We ask the ushers to come forward. You will follow their directions and instructions. They'll let you know what to do. When you come forward, we'll pray with you. We'll offer you communion, or you can serve yourself if you so choose. There's also a station over to the side where if you want to just have a private moment with God in communion, you can do that as well. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you for coming. Thank you for accepting the invitation.
Beautiful.
Take my hand.
still serving some people, communion. But I would like to say that we're closing Black History Celebration. This is the last day for us in the church. And we brought you just a little bit of our culture this morning. If you can rise as you are able. May the God of peace, who raised Christ from the dead, strengthen your inner being for every good work, for every call to a higher level. And may the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon you, dwell within you. I know I'm pushing you out of here with a tough assignment. Everybody cannot do it, but when the time, the appointed time comes, you will be able to do it. When the appointed time comes, you will meet a stranger out there and tell them your story. And they will be ready to hear it. The Holy Spirit, the Father and the Son, dwell within you this day and evermore. I won't say go in peace, go in prayer. And become a commitment. Amen. To the invitation of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.